Hello friends, I'm Dr. Kostub and I hope that you are safe at your home, healthy, and you are listening to following all guidelines that have been given by the government in your own interest and the interest of the entire community. Now, today we'll be discussing the current affairs questions for January 2020, the test that we had yesterday. First question, it is about the integrated steel hub. Now, Government of India wants to develop the eastern part of the country, and for that, we know that the Chotanagpur Plateau and the surrounding area is very rich in ferric as well as non-ferrous minerals. So here, government has brought this Purvodaya, that's what it's called, right? Purvodaya scheme, to have this integrated steel hub for the development of eastern part of the country. A few points about it. It is called the Scheme for Accelerated Development of Eastern India. The integrated steel hub is going to be established at Kolkata. It is under Industrial Revolution 4.0. So that's what the government is calling it. Then, as per the National Steel Policy, right, 70%, 75% of incremental capacity of steel production in India. And you are very well aware that industrial development of any country is measured by its consumption of steel, right? The way the development of a society or economy is measured by the use of electricity, industrial development is measured from the consumption of steel. So here, 75% of the incremental capacity of steel production for the country is going to come from the eastern part of the country. Now here, greenfield steel plants, this integrated steel hub, it's a greenfield project. Now what is the difference between greenfield and brownfield? Brownfield is capacity expansion or modernization of the existing project. But here when we speak about greenfield project, it's from the scratch, a new project that comes up. So here, under this policy of Purvodaya, they are going to have this integrated steel hub in Kolkata and other places also. So there are a number of states here. So here, the answer is D. All three statements are correct. Purvodaya scheme, hub, swift capacity addition, overall competitiveness, and lastly, the state of Odisha will get the highest investment share. Now, to be very honest and sincere, this third point, I've not found the numbers for that. I'll check again, but you also go through it. Ideally, what they mention is a huge investment is going into the eastern part. The first ISH is going to come to Kolkata. But then I don't have the direct source that whether the state-wise data, I have searched for it. So this third part is a gray area. You just keep it as it is, right? The rest of the things I've already covered here. We move to the second question. It's Northeast Gas Grid Project. Again, here, we understand that the fossil fuels are very costly and the government wants to increase industrial development, urban development, but by supplying electricity or energy through pipelines or gas. So here, all Northeast states, 8 Northeast states are to be covered. So here the point that excluding Sikkim and Tripura, so that's not the case. They are covering all 8 Northeast states. The total pipeline is going to be nearly 1656 kilometers in length. It is being implemented by IGGL, which is Indradhanush Gas Grid Limited. It's a like a special purpose vehicle which has number of government PSUs working under it. At presently, if you see the global average, that out of the total energy mix, how much is contributed by gas, the global average is 24%, whereas in India it is just 6.2%, right? 6.2%, so which is significantly low. That is why this project assumes significance that through pipeline, and see, pipeline offers you flexibility. You think about the northeastern states, the terrain, the ridge and valley topography that is present there. So because of that, transport through railways is problematic. Fuel cannot be transported through plane. It's not cost effective. The only other factor is you can transport it by road. But again, this is highly polluting, road transport as well as time consuming. Pipelines in such terrain can offer you the flexibility for capacity, more supply of energy or fuel in a very short period of time. So pipelines are being developed under this project. Target of the government is 15% by 2030. So by 2013, 15% of total energy mix of India is going to be from gas. Here, what are the major sectors that are going to be benefited by this gas supply? This is fertilizer, power, city gas distribution, and then the steel sector, right? Everywhere energy is required. And then gas, and here fertilizer industry is very critical because Northeast, we know horticulture and all, and the development that you're looking for. So we need more fertilizers, and fertilizer requires naphtha as a raw material. So gas provides not only the fuel or the energy for the industrialization, but also it provides raw material in the form of naphtha. So this gas or natural gas can be used as a raw material also for the production of fertilizers. Then the overall project is under what? It is called Urja Ganga Gas Pipeline Project. It's a major umbrella project here. So, when we speak about the second question, first statement, under this project, gas pipeline will be developed in Northeast states, excluding Sikkim. This is a wrong statement. The other two statements are correct. About funding, 60% funding is viability gap funding. And then it will provide natural gas supply to industrial, domestic, as well as CNG transport. Answer is B. Next, third question. It is about Startup Advisory Council. Now again, basically this is for what? Innovation. This is for what? For startup development. So a culture of creativity, innovation, government wants to bring in the economy. The government calls it officially knowledge economy. So here the wrong statement is second statement. The reason being, the ministry mentioned is financier, which is wrong. It should be commerce and industry ministry. Otherwise, the other two statements, 1 and 3, are correct. Next statement is about asset reconstruction companies. Now, in short, a word about asset reconstruction companies. These companies, you are aware of this, right? That we have a banking system. They provide credit. Big players in the market take the credit. Government also takes the credit. Most of the banking sector is in public sector. Public sector banks, PSBs. Whatever they gave, they didn't get it back. So it became NPA. Once NPA becomes, how do you resolve the issue, right? Here, the role of ARC, asset reconstruction companies, comes into play. What do? They buy the debt from the banks and all that. And then it is their responsibility to get the money from the people who have taken the debt or the companies. So they manage. So it is not just asset reconstruction, restructuring companies. It is also called as asset reconstruction, securitization. They also manage assets management, right? So here, ARC, specialized financial institution, this is correct, first statement. SARFAISI 2002, this is also 100% correct. It is securitization and reconstruction of financial assets and enforcement of Security Interest Act 2002, right? So this is correct. These ARCs, asset reconstruction companies, these are registered under RBI. This is important. They are registered under RBI, but they are regulated under this act, SARFAISI Act 2002. Next. So here answer is C, both. Fifth question, India Post Payment Banks. Here, incorrect statements are all four, right? Post Payment Bank is India's first payment bank. No, the first payment bank was Airtel Payments Bank Limited. So that was the first payments bank in India. Next, it offers services that are commercial banks offer. No, here you have to understand that these are, they can't give credit cards. They can't issue advance loans, right? So that is not same as some of the functions of commercial banks they can perform, but not all. So second statement is also wrong. No need to maintain SLR. This is also wrong because at least 75% of their demand deposits have to be in the form of SLR, right? They have to keep it as SLR. 75% of demand deposits as per RBI guidelines. So third statement is also wrong. And then it does not provide debit and credit card. It provides debit card. It cannot provide credit card. Clear? So all four statements are wrong here. I'll just sum up a few important points here. This India Post Payment Bank, 100% owned by government. It is under the Ministry of Communications. Then how it is different from a normal bank? The operations of this payment banks are small scale operations without involving any credit risk. Second, they can't issue advance loans or they cannot issue credit cards. 2015, RBI started giving them licenses. So this India Post Payment Bank got a license in 2015. Over 2 crore customers, this is a success story, right? You know, Indian postal network is one of the biggest networks in the world. So they've reached every village nearly. So more than 6 lakh villages. So here 1.5 lakh branches, if I'm not wrong. So here they have this 2 crore customers. Very recently, they crossed that threshold. And then Aadhaar-enabled payment services are allowed. They run through this India Post Payment Bank. First was Airtel Payments Bank Limited, and 75% is SLR. I've already spoken about it. So answer is D. Sixth, Global Risk Report is straightforward. Answer is B, World Economic Forum. Next, seventh, India IMD has fixed standards for onset and withdrawal. Now, the point is, in NCERT, there is a map given of the dates as the monsoon progresses in the country. So, as per that map, answer is C. 1, 2, 3, 4. Guwahati, Hyderabad, Nagpur, and then Patna, right? Which is logical also. So, eastern side gets it first. Then it progresses to the central part, and then the two branches merge, and then they move along the foothills towards Delhi. So, here, it is 1, 2, 3, 4. Question number 8. It is about hydrochlorofluorocarbons and Montreal Protocol, about ozone depleting substances. So, incorrect statements are 3 and 4. First, 2 are correct. Hydrochlorofluorocarbons are water soluble. No, they are not water soluble, right? They are soluble in organic compounds. So, they don't dissolve in water. They dissolve in organic, that is carbon containing solvents, right? So, that statement is wrong. And hydrochlorofluorocarbons can be reduced by promoting foam sector. No, it's other way around, right? You have to check or stop the foam sector to control them, right? So, 3 and 4 are wrong. So, incorrect, which they have asked, it is, answer is B. Now, we look at question number 9th. It is about Asiatic and African cheetah. First two statements are correct. The third statement, it is interchanged. African cheetah is vulnerable. Asiatic cheetah has seen more stress on its population. That is why it is critically endangered as per the red list of IUCN. So, answer is A, 1 and 2. Question number 10, Ramsar site and the state where this site occurs. You have to match the pairs. First two again are correct here. Nandur Madhyameshwar Bird Sanctuary, that's in Maharashtra. Gurdaspur is in Punjab. Nawabganj, it is in Unnao. Unnao is in UP, not Bihar, right? So, Nawabganj, Unnao, UP, it is also called as Chandrasekhar Azad Bird Sanctuary. This Nawabganj, it's in UP, Unnao, not Bihar. So, third statement, third is wrong. Answer is C, 1 and 2. Question number 11th, it is about Project Netra. Now, what is this Project Netra? It's space debris. So, here, it is an early warning system in space to detect space debris and other hazards to Indian satellites. So, whenever ISRO is sending satellites in the space, they may face certain problems or hazards. We need an early warning system, and that is called Project Netra. This is by ISRO. It is first, now it will be implemented by ISRO in stages. First, it is for the low Earth orbit, LEO. After that, we'll go step by step to ensure that even in geo, 36,000 kilometers above the surface, we'll be able to have this early warning system to protect the Indian satellites, that is geostationary and geosynchronous, from space debris. Here, the significance is it is able to spot debris as small as 10 centimeters and at a range of nearly 3,400 kilometers. Now, it is equal to the space orbit of nearly 2,000 kilometers. India on ground also has MOTR, which is associated with this. This is called Multi-Object Tracking Radar. Multi-Object Tracking Radar. So, this is about question number 11th. Answer is A. Question 12th, gravitational waves. We are very well aware that statement 1 is correct. Statement 2, they are yet to be detected. No, LIGO. It was detected. We have detected this. So, second statement is wrong. Question number 13, SNOW-X. Now, what is this? This is NASA's program. First, at present, it is being implemented in North America only. What is this program all about? If there is a particular area which depends on glacial water, then the amount of snowfall that has occurred there, measuring everything with the help of satellites, NASA tells you how much water will be available when the glacier melts. This is significant because in this age, we know that presently there is 1.2 billion people or nearly one-sixth of humanity that depends for their water requirements on water available from glacial melt. So, this is about SNOW-X. Answer is true. First, for a better understanding of how much water is contained in each winter snowfall and how much will be available when it melts in the spring, CSIR has launched a project. No, that is the problem. Everything is correct. It is NASA, not CSIR. It's not Indian project. It's NASA's project. Answer is B. 14, Polycrack technology. Now, what is this Polycrack all about? See, basically, this is a project that is being implemented. It's a technology. So, first and foremost, Polycrack is not a project. It is a technology. This technology is being followed in the Indian Railways for the first time. In India, this is the fourth such attempt to implement this technology for waste to energy conversion. So what is polycrack? Waste to energy conversion. What is this, or what is the significance? It is world's first patented heterogeneous catalytic process. Technical, right? World's first patented heterogeneous catalytic process, which converts multiple feedstocks, wastes, right? Multiple feedstocks into hydrocarbon, liquid fuels, gases, carbon, and water. It can be fed with e-waste and plastics, in addition to all other types of waste that you generally feed. And this is the benefit of this polycrack, that you don't have to segregate at source. No matter what the waste is, you feed it into the polycrack technology, it will give you, it's a closed loop cycle, right? So it doesn't generate many polluting substances. So that is here. However, the process causes atmospheric emission. No, it doesn't cause much of the atmospheric emission. Rather, the surrounding area is very much neat, clean, and does not have degradation in air or water quality. It's a closed loop system, no hazardous pollutants, and it's a zero discharge process. Produces light diesel oil. So it produces energy, light diesel oil. Pre-segregation is not required. The plant takes very small area. Even the initial cost and the operating cost, the capital requirements and operating cost is not too high. So this is very good, and Indian Railways has followed the technology presently for the first time. So answer is A1. Question number 15. National Cyber Crime Reporting Portal. Now, ultimately, this is by Ministry of Home Affairs. There's no doubt at all. This technology, or this National Cyber Crime Reporting Portal, this is for what? Majorly women, right? So cyber stalking, rapes, violent videos, sexual abuse, child pornography, all this has to be prevented. And for that, Ministry of Home Affairs has come up with this portal. But along with it, there are certain specialized crimes, like even financial frauds. So it is mentioned here in statement 3. Portal also focuses on specific crimes like financial crime and social media related crimes like cyberbullying and all. So cyber stalking, cyberbullying. So all these are also dealt with. It is under National Mission for Safety of Women. It allows anonymous reporting. Now, this is the biggest problem with policing, that you call them on 100. The first thing they ask you, your details, right? So there are many people who are willing to help, but they don't want their name and get into the process. So here, this is significant that this portal allows for anonymous reporting also. You just can log in and report the complaint. Now, so that protects what? That keeps confidentiality. Your privacy is also protected. Question number 16. So here, answer is 1, 2, 3, correct option regarding 15th. Answer is C, 1, 2, 3. Question number 16, Corruption Perception Index. Now, this is by Transparency International. Index is prepared annually. First statement is right. Zero score suggests very clean. No, it is the other way around. Zero score is extremely corrupt, highly corrupt. And 100 is clean, right? So second statement is wrong. India improved its ranking by 2 places. No, rather India has gone down by 2 places, right? So from 78, our rank has gone to 80. So I'll just read out. The score of India is 41 out of 100. 41 out of 100 score. Ranking is 80 out of 180 nations, right? India's ranking is 80 out of 180 nations. And this is one rare condition where we have equaled the Chinese. So on rank 80, we have China with us, Ghana with us, Morocco with us, and Benin. It's a very small West African country, right? Here, zero means highly corrupt. India has slipped by 2 positions. Top country here is Denmark and New Zealand. Clean, efficient administration. Bottom is, as expected, Syria, South Sudan, and Somalia, right? All three having political issues and violence and crisis since a couple of years. Right? So answer is B, only one. Question 17, Article 131, original jurisdiction. I don't have to explain that to you. Question 18, enemy property. Now this is like after the 65-71 war, we have this enemy property thing, that Pakistani people having owned certain things, and then there is a custodian for that who works under, here it is given Ministry of External Affairs, that is wrong. It is Ministry of Home Affairs, as expected, right? They are the custodian is under Ministry of Home Affairs. Idea is that the first statement is correct. There is no problem here. But there is something that I want to add here. When you speak about this custodian or this enemy property, the custodian is under Ministry of Home Affairs. Now, such properties, right? Whatever the income these properties have, the custodian charges a fee, 2%, right? So 2% of income is charged as fee, which goes to the custodian to run its expenses. However, if there is income from this property, rental or otherwise, that goes to RBI, right? Next. Question number 19, section 144. Now, this is in news, Delhi and rest of the country, now nearly everywhere, this is a curfew. So, what is the situations of apprehended danger? Section 144 is of CRPC. 5 or more people are not allowed at one place, right? Sanchar Bandi, unlawful assembly, plus you are not allowed to carry weapon. Anyone, right, in any area, if there is 144, you cannot go out with any weapon, right? Otherwise, you'll be in jail for 3 years maximum, right? Executive magistrate declares this 144 nuisance or apprehended danger. So here the question mentions situations of apprehended danger, option D, but it is also nuisance, so public nuisance. And then maximum punishment is 3 years applicable. So the way we speak about state emergency, here also it is applicable for 2 months only, right? But it is extendable. Maximum how much? 6 months. Next, this is about question number 20. National Commission for Minority Education Institutions. 1 and 3 is correct. Second statement is wrong. One or more minorities can establish a single institute. That's not given in the constitution, right? Answer is A, 1 and 3. Balfour Declaration. Now, this is the basic declaration that resulted into the formation of this Israel in the Palestinian land. In 1917, Britain has declared. So, this is the Israel-Palestine issue. Balfour Declaration, 1917, it was the public statement by British government for the establishment of national home for Jewish people in Palestine. That is how it reads, right? Establishment of national home for the Jewish people in Palestine, right? Question number 22, Wakataka Dynasty. Now, Wakatakas, they are the successor of Satvahanas. Here, what is wrong? Wakatakas, Vaishnavite, they're not Vaishnavite. Rather, they're believed to be Brahmanical, right? Brahmanical origin. This Wakataka kingdom was below Narmada, right? And the founder here was Vindhyashakti, but not much is given in history about Vindhyashakti. Here, which of the above statements are correct? 1 and 2. Third, Vaishnavite tradition, wrong, Brahmanical. Question 23, Pithora art. No, basically, when we speak about Pithora, it's in Gujarat, central Gujarat. But this is less an art and more a method of communication, their form of writing, right? It's kind of a ritual, right? This Pithora art. What is this all about? It's in Gujarat, majorly central Gujarat, Tejgad, around area around Tejgad. Two communities or two, this is also called tribal art. So two tribes follow this. What are these? Rathwas and Bilalas. Rathwas, R-A-T-H-W-A-S and Bilalas. Pithora paintings, these are more of a ritual than an art. To thank God, why do they paint? To thank God or to ask for a boon. So people who have a problem, they go there, there's a priest kind of thing, and then this art is performed to seek solution to problems, right? So either you thank God or you ask for a boon or a resolution to a problem. Next. So here, all of the above. Answer is A. Question 24. Archaea. Now, this is distinct group from bacteria. This is single celled. So, it is prokaryotes, right? Prokaryotes. So, here, which of the above statements are correct? 1 and 3. Primitive group of microbes, extreme habitats, even in Dead Sea and all, around Dead Sea. So, these are found in extreme habitats. They are very fast growing. No, rather, these do not multiply by meiosis or mitosis, right? These are single celled. So, binary fission. They multiply by binary fission. So, it takes time. So, second statement is wrong. Third, they are known for antioxidant activity with application of eco-friendly wastewater treatment. Yes, it is correct. Next, Japan, strongest passport. Now, what is strong passport? Holders of this passport can access without a prior visa. A is correct. Question number 26, Suranga Bavdi. Now, when we speak about Suranga Bavdi, it is associated with Karej system, which is presently also found in Bidar area of Karnataka. This is Adil Shahi. This technique originally is Persian, But Adil Shah, he followed it, and it is one of the very good traditional systems of water conservation and management, right? Presently, Bijapur, Karnataka, ancient water system of Deccan Plateau, UNESCO has that. It is tagged under ancient water system of Deccan Plateau. It was built by Adil Shah. Karej is technique originated in Persia, right? So this is all about this Karej system. One and two, third is wrong. It has been included in UNESCO's World Monument Watch List. So correct statements, one and two only, right? So here it is, not a monument per se. Question number 27. Who is this person? This is Lala Lajpat Rai. D. Next, 28. Global Gender Gap Index 2020. All of the above, right? 1, 2, 3, all are correct. 29. Crown Act. Now, Crown Act, this crown has a full form. It is creating a respectful and open world for natural hair. This is in US. So, people there are being discriminated on the basis of the kind of hair they have, hair systems. And then you are aware that the English, then Afro-Americans, then Latin Americans, they have different types of hairs, and then that becomes a cause of discrimination. So very recently, California followed this enacted this law, Crown Act. So it aims to protect people of color from being discriminated against for their natural hair. Answer is C. And this discrimination occurs where, and where would this act be applicable? It's education, employment, and even housing. Right. Next. Lastly, it is question number 30. Government instant messaging system. Government has become very, very aware about the threats that the technology platforms, social media platforms, and then government communications presently are being conducted through these platforms. But we know that the data goes to foreign country. They are headquartered there. Even data is not stored in country. That leads to very problems regarding your security, sovereignty. So government, for its own security and sovereignty, keeping privacy and maintaining efficiency, keeping data in the country, they are bringing up this GIMS, which is one-to-one messaging as well as group messaging. But here, what is wrong is statement 3. It says that no provision, specific provision for document and media sharing. No, that is rather the strength of it, that it allows for one-to-one communication, group communication, as well as the hierarchical arrangement of Indian administration is, it allows the sharing of documents in line with this hierarchy. So there is a specific provision in GIMS for documents and media sharing. So incorrect statement is only 3, right? With this, I end this discussion session. I wish you good health. Stay at home, stay safe, and study well. Thank you.